Welcome back. In our last episode, we watched a little YouTube and we discussed numeric representation and choosing the correct numeric representation for applications we're designing. Now that we're deep into the numbers, let's discuss coercion and conversion. For instance, I'll take a double and an I-32. And add them together. Now, what's that little red dot there? Coercion is occurring there. It doesn't occur due to the order that I'm wiring these up into the function. In fact, if I wire the I-32 first, then the double, the I-32 is still coerced. But what does it mean? LabVIEW is changing the data representation in order to support the operation. That change requires a little extra memory. For instance, let's count up the memory this little VI is taking. 8 bytes here, 4 bytes here, another 8 bytes here, and another 8 bytes right there for the coercion itself. In other words, LabVIEW takes the value that's in this I-32 and changes the data representation without changing the value if it can. In this case, no problem. We can make the data width wider without changing the data value. So if I had 112 here, added to another 100, and run it, no problem. We get the right answer out. So what? Is coercion bad? Well, as we said, it uses a little extra memory. So if we can reduce that, that's a good thing. In many cases, we can't avoid using the extra memory because this may be coming from some other place. Maybe I'm reading a value from a database or from a DLL, and what comes out is always going to be an I-32, so I have to change it at some point. So should I always just let LabVIEW change it? Can I change it myself? I sure can. I can right-click on that wire and insert from my numeric conversion palette, right here, two double precision float. An I-32 goes in, a double comes out. No coercion dot anymore. Am I using more memory? Well, I'm actually using the same amount of memory as before. 4 bytes here, another 8 bytes for the reallocation. So it's the advantage to converting it versus letting LabVIEW coerce it. The big reason is we choose where the conversion occurs. Because if LabVIEW chooses, it may choose to do it in a place that's not as efficient. Let's look at an example of that. Let's say I make an array, a big array. One megabyte. So we're adding an array of 1 million elements to a scalar and getting a resulting array. The scalars are being added to every element. To help us understand what LabVIEW is doing here, we're going to go to our tools and go to our profile performance and memory tool. And I'll click on profile memory usage and memory usage. And then I start it. I run the VI and stop it. And I'll change my size units to megabytes because we see there's a little bit of noise here at the lower level, but we really care about the big chunks. 16 megabytes in this case are being used. That makes sense. 8 megabytes for the original array, then another 8 megabytes for the edited array. Let's see some coercion occur now. I'm gonna come over here to the element input. Right now I'm making an array of doubles, but I'm gonna make an array of singles. As we see immediately, I get the red coercion dot there, which means I'm going to be taking an array of 1 million singles and changing it to an array of 1 million doubles in order to add it to the double. Let's profile this memory usage. Take a look at that, much higher. So when LabVIEW decides where to coerce, we can use a lot more memory. But this is an easy fix. I'll use quick drop this time. Control spacebar. And control I to insert it. Very nice. And run it again. So we've definitely reduced our memory usage, but not down to the original 16 megabytes we saw previously. In fact, if I take this out, quick drop again, control spacebar, control R, and then change this back to a double, and reprofile this, we'll see that we're still at 24. Now don't lose confidence in the profile performance and memory. It may not be exactly consistent for the same VIs, depending on what else is happening in our LabVIEW environment, but it will consistently show that coercing large arrays, like we saw, uses more memory than converting data types in appropriate places. So if I'm not dealing with large data arrays, might coercion be safe just for scalars? Well, sometimes we can still get bad results. Let's make a simple example. We'll change this to a U8. And this numeric to an I8. I'm going to add them together. Before I add, which will be coerced into the other? Think about it, and now you know. The signed integer is coerced into the unsigned integer. Just remember, that's a rule LabVIEW follows. We always coerce signed integers to unsigned integers if they're the same data width. Now, if this happens, we can imagine something could go wrong. I'll create an indicator. If a signed integer is being coerced to an unsigned integer, then obviously if we have a negative number in here, something could go wrong. Let's make it go wrong. I'll make this -2, and this 10. Run it. What do I get? 8. Now that's not so weird, because 10 plus -2 is 8. But if the answer should be negative, we get a problem. So let's flip these. 2 and -10. Run it. 248. That's not right. But by now, we know what's going on. The values are rolling over to the max size of the data type, and we get a data value we don't necessarily expect if we haven't accounted for the coercion that's taking place. If you'd like to know more, there's a helpful document in your LabVIEW help called Coercion Dots. It's also online, as you can see here. It goes over many of the topics we just discussed. Like programming in LabVIEW, we want to avoid coercion, but we really like it if you came and visited us at sixclear.com/labviewtraining. We have a whole course full of this good stuff. We also do live training. Maybe you'll meet me or another of our fantastic Sixclear instructors. Maybe Jassem. Look, he's smiling. See you soon.